I look out here and I see that there's a lot of hope, okay? A lot of different people from a lot of different walks of life. And I'd like to introduce just a few of them. The Kwiatkowski family first, foremost, Karen. And Karen, would you stand up? That's right. And Karen's husband, Hap. You don't have to stand up, Hap. And Ron, Karen's brother. And Karen's mother is here. And Peggy, I would ask you to stand up. Peggy is of my vintage. Hap's mother, Helen, is also here. Hap's mother, would you please stand up? Helen Kwiatkowski. It's so nice to have people here that are almost as old as I am. It's a real trick. Now, Karen and Hap's daughter is here, Katie. And where's Mike? Mike, yeah, we might get the premiere. So those are the Kwiatkowskis. There are lots of other folks here, but I won't call them out by name. I will mention who they are. And what I'd like to say here is that it's a treat to welcome the wider Church of the Savior community. If you guys could just raise your hands, you don't have to get up. Whoa, okay. This is special for me because I've been here for 20 years now. This is my 20th year teaching and also connected in other ways with the Tell the Word operation, a nonprofit that is based here. Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity and Sam Adams Associates. Okay, a smattering. We live in different parts of the world, actually, as well as different parts of the country. A Catholic worker, from Washington and other plowshare folks who spent a lot of time in jail. Veterans for Peace. Okay. Now, I should mention that there are tables back there where there's some little literature about Veterans for Peace, also about plowshares and also about World Beyond War, and also about people who don't like nuclear weapons. You can refresh yourself right there. Ardith has just raised her hand. She and Carol sitting with her, I think, have spent a combined, decade or two having done plowshares actions. And Megan Rice sitting right behind there. Megan, could you stand up just so people can see you because you're not all that tall. when Megan was younger, like about 4 years ago, she and other Catholic workers got into the and Michael Wally here, yeah. Got into the plutonium plant there in Tennessee and paid a heavy price for it, needed
Oak Ridge,
right? That's where the plutonium, right? Yeah.
Still making weapons of mass destruction.
They're still doing it.
Since 1940.
Since 1940, making weapons of mass destruction. Since 1940. Okay, Consortium News and other associates there, all right, is Joe Warrior here?
Yeah.
Oh, there he is. Now, Joe is our new editor-in-chief. And other truth-telling people like Gareth Porter over there and all kinds of good journalists here who tell the truth. And of course, not last but not least, the deep state community. Those of you from the FBI or CIA or Department of Homeland Security, please raise your hand. It's always one. Well, they don't identify themselves, but know that you're welcome if you're lurking in the back. Now, the order of march here will be pretty simple. We're going to ask Larry Wilkerson to start off with a little talk, and then we're going to have the presentation of the award. And then Karen is going to give a talk, and then we'll have questions and answers, and that's when we involve everyone here. So as you're listening to the talks, please take copious notes, and then you'll remember what you wanted to ask about. I'd like now, and it's my pleasure now, and my honor now to invite Larry Wilkerson, who is a previous Sam Adams awardee to come and give the early speech. I won't say a lot about Larry, because most of you know a lot about Larry. I will say that he knows what war is like. He knows what war is like. It's in Vietnam. And he knows what deceit, he knows what sending people to war on lies is like. And to his credit, he's been speaking out about that. And it's an honor to say, Larry, where are you? Thank you. Thank you, Larry.
Can you all hear me without that?
Yeah.
I don't like microphones. I saw this movie maybe a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago, when it wasn't quite finished. It is much better now. I saw it with Rob Reiner, Joe Galloway, Chief of Staff of the Army, former Chief of Staff of the Army, Ken Shinseki, Warren Strobel, Jonathan Landay, John Walcott, all the major characters in the movie, and we all sat around after the movie and had a good jaw. Because it's a pretty damned accurate movie. And what they've done in the cutting rooms and the editing rooms since I saw that raw outtake makes it an even better movie, makes it more accurate. In fact, they even took a couple of my hints. I saw them in there. And a couple of other people's hints who were there also. It's a very powerful movie, and it's largely, as was alleged in the movie, accurate. One of the best decisions I ever made in my life, I didn't know it at the time, was I hired Joe Galloway. And Joe became a member of Colin Powell's speechwriting shop, which I managed. And as you saw, became a real conduit for information going out to McClatchy, then Knight Ritter, versus McClatchy now. But what I'd like to talk to you about just for a brief moment tonight is not so much that, because that's vetted. It's a done deal. As tragic and horrific as it was, and it is still spinning out, because this strategic decision by an American president set 400 million Arabs and all the rest of the people, from Kurds to Baluchs to you name it amongst them, at war with one another. All in the name of Israel's security. That was the strategy. We've all discovered it now. It's as clear as day that Paul Wolfowitz, Douglas Feith, John Hanna, more about John Hanna in a moment, were all basically card-carrying members of the Likud party, working for Israel. Most of them had dual membership or dual citizenship, and most of them had at a time in their life worked in Israel. If there is a foreign agent operating in the United States to the disinterest of the United States, more often than not, it is not Russia, it is not China, it is not some special interest group concocted out of a combination of people across the globe who want to harm us. It's Israel. It's the state of Israel. They can come through those back doors and call me an anti-Semite all they want to. As the president of the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, the most Likud-like entity in America today, said, anti-Semitism isn't what it used to be. Because basically, Americans are waking up. 72% of Jewish Americans under the age of 35 now think Netanyahu and his government are horrible. Think about that for a minute. They are losing Jewish Americans. If they're losing Jewish Americans, ultimately they're going to lose America. But lots of damage can be done in the interregnum. And that's what I wanted to talk to you briefly about, because we are doing this again right now with regard to Iran. We are doing it with regard to the original plan was all of them. When I went to the Pentagon, when they allowed me to go there, in 2001 and 2002, I saw the war plan. Just as General Wes Clark has talked about and others have talked about who were honest, I saw the war plan. I thought at the time it was contingency planning and chalked it up to the military doing its job. You know, if you're going to invade one country and there are other countries around there, you want a contingency plan for what happens if one of the other countries suddenly attacks you. It wasn't, except that it was a contingency that everybody wanted to do. In other words, it was going to be Syria, it was going to be Lebanon, it was going to be Iraq, it was going to be Iran, it was going to be the whole place in order to make Israel safe in perpetuity. And in the meantime, if chaos were created, that'd make Israel safe too, because chaos means the Arabs can't get together, the Persians can't get their act together, no one can combine in order to defeat Israel. And now you've got this poisonous, incestuous relationship between Mohammed bin Salman in Saudi Arabia, his mentor in the United Arab Emirates in Doha, and Israel. You've got an alliance between these people. Think about that for a moment. Think about when Ronald Reagan couldn't sell F-15s to Saudi Arabia because of the objections of Tel Aviv. And now we have an alliance between Riyadh, the real sponsor of state terrorism in this world, and Tel Aviv. And believe me, Bibi Netanyahu would ally with the devil if it kept him in political power. That's the real reason Bibi does what he does, to stay in personal political power. If he ever leaves it, he's going to be indicted and put in jail. Ariel Sharon, the gentleman who preceded Bibi by one or two, would have been put in jail himself if he weren't dying of cancer when he left office, because he was as guilty as Bibi. There seems to be something about these right-wing governments in Israel that remind me a lot about the right-wing governments in America. They're corrupt, they're criminals, they're more like mafia than they are democratic leaders. But we are going there again, and it's as sophisticated, if not more so, than it was before. The Foundation for Defense of Democracies features, for example, amongst its stellar cast, John Hanna. John Hanna is a card-carrying member of the Likud Party. John Hanna shouted me the entire time I was at Langley at the CIA with Powell getting ready for the UN presentation. John Hanna stuck to me like glue. John Hanna wrote the script that Powell was supposed to deliver at the United Nations. Powell was really suspicious of that script, so he threw it out and went to the October 2002 National Intelligence Estimate, which turned out to be just as bad as the script, except it was sourced with genuine intelligence. That is to say, it actually had some place you could go and say, who said this? Who did this? When did they say it? When did they do it? What's your judgment of the reliability of that data and so forth? What John Hanna gave Powell was just a script, like a stage play, like a screenplay. Like, you know, you're going to go on the theater, you're going to go on stage in the theater, and you're going to give this presentation. That's what John Hanna gave. So John had to follow me and Powell around Langley the entire 7 days and nights we were there getting ready and make sure that we didn't too mess up what he wanted to be done. And what did he want to be done? Exactly what his boss, Richard Cheney, wanted to be done. It's a more nefarious business right now, though. I'll take Q&A in just a minute. It's a much more nefarious business right now. You have got billions of dollars coming in from Saudi Arabia. You've got billions of dollars from U.S. billionaires like Sheldon Adelson and Mark Singer and others. And it's all fueling the Congress of the United States. I've been on the Hill for the past 6 months trying to get the War Powers Resolution used in the House and the Senate to get the United States out of the brutal war in Yemen, which is a travesty beyond travesties. Humanitarian disaster. And we are participating. In fact, if you talk to the average Middle Easterner, they'll tell you they think it's a war, a proxy war for the United States, not the other way around. That is to say, we're the ones using the Saudis to do our bidding, principally against Iran, but against anybody that wants to stand up to us. So it's not anything we should be involved in, and yet you have no idea how torturous and difficult it's been getting individual senators of both aisles, Republicans and Democrats, and representatives to recognize, one, that it's not in our interest to be in that war, two, that the people we're supporting are heinous characters, as has been demonstrated most vividly by the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, And yet you sit and you think, well, one person? And all of a sudden everybody gets energized over it? I can tell you that that man's death has done more to help us get this legislation through. We just got it voted on in the Senate, and we got 63 senators to vote for. It reminds me of Stalin's comment about, you know, you kill one man, it's murder. You kill a million, it's a statistic. We've been killing thousands in Yemen, and we need to stop. And so if any of you know anybody you can talk to over there on the Hill about this, it's coming up again in the House. Paul Ryan is going to derail it again, probably. But I guarantee you when the Democrats get in there in January, it will come up again. It's 142 in the House right now. Maybe he won't derail it. Maybe he'll let it go through. But if he doesn't, then the Democratic House will put it through. And then we're going to have a conference. The bills in the Senate and the House will have to be reconciled. And then the president will veto it, probably. Then we've got to try and get him to override his veto, just like they did with the first War Powers Resolution. Nixon vetoed it. And the Congress was so angry, it passed it over his veto. That's what we need to do, and we need constituents, we need phone calls, we need emails, and so forth. The other aspect of this, going to war with Iran, I do not think the president, and this is a really difficult statement for me to make, I've just spent two seminars with some brilliant students studying this administration. I don't know, and my students don't know where this president's gonna go on any issue at any given time. I have no idea. We've come to the conclusion that he is the most mercurial, unpredictable, uncertain person who's ever sat in the Oval Office. You don't know what he's going to do. You simply don't know. That's dangerous, though, because there are people around him who do know what they want to do. And one of the most powerful of those people is John Bolton, the National Security Advisor. And they want Iran next. They missed out on Assad. They missed out on Bashar al-Assad and brought the Russians in and brought the Iranians into Syria. And let me tell you about something you probably don't know anything about. I wonder if Donald Trump knows about it. We are building bases in Syria right now. I just had a Marine tell me that he'd come from a base in Syria where there were Burger Kings, airfields with jets taking off from them, not Syrian airfields, U.S. contractor-built airfields in Syria. So we're now establishing ourselves in Syria. And the real troop total there, he told me, is approaching 12,000. We're in another country, and we're there because we are going to stay there until every single Iranian is gone. That's the mantra in the Pentagon right now. When's the last time anybody told you about that? Or any of the American people about this? We're investing country after country. We're going after all these people under the AUMF that was issued, the authorization for the use of military force that was issued after 9/11. It's still being used. The authorities are not there for these wars, and yet they are acting as if they are. And if we don't watch it, we're gonna be at war with half the world and sanctioning the other half. This is an incredibly difficult and dangerous situation for this country to be in. We are at a point where even the Congressional Budget Office, with its trepidation to do this sort of thing in the face of the Congress, says that within 4 or 5 years, that $700 billion defense budget you see right now will be at $800 or $900 billion. The interest payments on our $22 trillion debt will be the same, and together, and you can't get away with not paying those interest payments. You can forget the deficit if you want to, but you got to make the annual interest payments or you default. Together, they will consume the federal budget. Nothing left. The entitlements on the one hand, the defense budget, interest payments on the debt, nothing left. So forget about infrastructure repairs, forget about public education, forget about all the things that we really need desperately to do in this country, because we're gonna spend ourselves into bankruptcy. You saw that figure up there? That's not the right figure. Go look at the cost of war project analysis at Brown University. The right figure is 5 to 7 trillion, not 2.5 trillion. And the right figure on casualties is probably upwards of 2 million. And the right figure on refugees, as the UN pointed out the other day, from that region is somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 million. Worldwide, it's 65 million. And these people are moving in large part because of no water, no food, and climate change. And we have a president who denies that it's happening. We are in deep trouble. Physically, morally, ethically, empire-wise, we're in deep trouble. And I've been in every state in this union in the past 7-8 years, and the American people do not know that we're in that trouble. Some of them intuit it, some of them suspect it, some of them are worried and don't know exactly what they're worried about, but by and large, they don't know the simple facts that I've just told you, that we are a national security state whose reason for existence is war, whose principal instrument of interfacing with the world is the military, which costs almost $1 trillion every year, and we can't keep it up. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Larry. Well, we are going to take questions right after Karen speaks, but if it's a real urgent one, we'll entertain it now. Okay. Yeah, Gary?
Well, I just wanted to perhaps add to what Larry just said,
specifically about Yemen. Speak up and stand up, please. You're on
about
TV.
About what needs to happen on Yemen. Of course, I applaud what's happening right now with the war powers based approach legislatively to end U.S. involvement in it. But I want to emphasize just how vital it is that we think, we meaning people who care about ending that war, think one step further, think ahead to the necessity to really stop the war by ending the shipments of spare parts to the Saudi and UAE air forces. That's the way to end it. That requires another piece of legislation beyond this. And I know some people are thinking about it, but I want everybody to realize how important it is to get behind that as soon as possible and make that happen to save hundreds of thousands of lives.
Thank you, Gareth. And thank you again, Larry, for letting out the bold truth here, as Karen did with her Knight Ritter journalists. I don't need to tell you how dire the need right now is for people like Karen and others from within and from without the national security community to let the rest of us know what's going on. As Larry pointed out, Iran is going down the same path in terms of false claims. Iran is the foremost sponsor of international terrorism. Four decades ago it was, right? No longer. Iran's working on a nuclear weapon. Well, read Gareth's book. They never were working on a nuclear weapon. At least, if they were, they stopped in 2003 as soon as we invaded Iraq. So, all this stuff needs to be brought out, and it's just delight. I'm just delighted to say that Karen brings us all out to show with one person what one person can do. Now, before I forget, there is a website that talks about Sam Adams Associates. This is our 17th award, okay? The first one was Colleen Rowley back in 2002. samadamsaward.ch. So once again, samadamsaward.ch. It's a secure website. That's Switzerland, okay? Now, our custom with Sam Adams Award ceremonies is to have an earlier awardee present Karen with our Oscar. And as some of you know, our Oscar is a Corner-Brightener candlestick holder to be used in shining light into dark spaces. And I owe the previous executive director here for that insight as to what kind of Oscar. Elizabeth McMeekin was the one that came up with that idea, and we were off and running. Now, As you'll see, if you look to the left or the right, to the left, I suppose, John Kiriakou, who won the award 2 years ago, will be presenting the Corner-Brightener Candlestick holder while I read the citation. Now, Cy Hirsch won the award last year. He had a previous engagement. He couldn't come tonight. John won it the year before, and so that we're asking John to do that. So, Karen, would you come forward now, and I will read the citation. This is the first year we've actually lit the candles, so we always break precedent. The Sam Adams Associates for Integrity and Intelligence presents this Integrity Award to Karen Kwiatkowski. Know ye by these presents that Karen Kwiatkowski is hereby honored with the traditional Sam Adams Corner-Brightener Candlestick holder in symbolic recognition of her courage in shining light into dark places. If you see something, say something. You hear that a lot, right? Karen Kwiatkowski took that saying to heart. She saw Pentagon superiors acting as eager accomplices in the Cheney-Bush administration's deceit in launching a war of aggression on Iraq, and she said something. She saw something, and she said something. And she helped night reporters Warren Strobel and Jonathan Landay see beneath the official lies and get the sordid story right before the war, okay? Before the war, that's guts, right? You hadn't even retired yet. Pretty risky, okay? Colleen Riley hadn't retired yet either. She spoke out. This is the caliber of people you have here, guts. Karen's courage brings to mind the clarion call of Rabbi Abraham Heschel against perpetrators of an earlier war, Vietnam. Few are guilty, he said, but all are responsible. Indifference to evil is more insidious than evil itself, and Karen wouldn't be indifferent to evil. Ed Snowden, Sam Adams awardee in 2013, noted that we tend to ignore some degree of evil in our daily life, but as Ed put it, we also have a breaking point. And when people find that, they act, as did Karen, as did 16 of Karen's predecessors honored with this award, including, of course, John. With all the gloom and doom enveloping us, we tend to wonder whether people with the conscience and courage of Ed or Karen or John still exists in and outside the national security establishment. Our country is certainly in dire need of such patriots of this kind. Meanwhile, as we wait for them, we call to mind the courageous example, not only of Karen and Ed, but also of Cody Rowley and Elizabeth Gunn, our first two awardees, who took great risks in trying to head off the attack on Iraq. And we can honor Chelsea Manning and Julian Assange, also prior awardees. Assange now being isolated in what the UN has called twice arbitrary detention and in great immediate peril, given the latest news. Why? For exposing the war crimes resulting from that Iraq war. Karen Kwiatkowski has made her unique contribution to this company of conscience and courage, and Sam Adams Associates are pleased to honor her. Presented this 8th day of December 2018 in Washington by admirers of the example set by the late CIA analyst Sam Adams. John, would you do the honors?
Congratulations. Thank you. can everybody hear me, or do I need to use the mic? I need to use the mic. The mic? Okay, here we go. I am honored beyond belief to be the 2018 recipient of the Sam Adams Award, and I thank Ray McGovern and the Sam Adams Associates for integrity and intelligence, Veterans Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, Warren Strobel and Jonathan Landay of Knight Ridder, and Rob Reiner for putting together a great movie that was so consistently truthful that for me it looked almost like a documentary. I want to also thank the late David Hackworth, a man I never met, who published my first anonymous essays from the Pentagon, and of course Lou Rockwell, who has published so many of my essays examining and trying to understand our government and our offensive policies over the past 15 years. There have been many American patriots and truth tellers who have received the honor you have given me tonight, and I'm going to name some of them here because I do stand in awe of them. Colleen Rowley, FBI, Catherine Gunn, British Intelligence, Sibel Edmonds of the FBI, Craig Murray, UK Foreign Service, Sam Provance, a former US Army Sergeant, Major Frank Grebel of the Danish Army Intelligence, Larry Wilkerson, you met him tonight if you hadn't already met him, great guy, former Chief of Staff to Colin Powell's State, Julian Assange, Thomas Drake of NSA, Jesslyn Raddick, formerly of the Department of Justice, Thomas Fingar, former Deputy Director of National Intelligence and Director of National Intelligence Council, Ed Snowden, Chelsea Manning, and Bill Binney of the NSA, and of course John Kiriakou, we have here. I'm very humbled, and I'm almost speechless tonight, but not entirely speechless. My backstory is pretty well known to most people here and to anyone who is interested in understanding U.S. war policy in the early 2000s. I had a small role to play in concert with a number of other truth tellers in media and in the national security bureaucracy. For every one of us, there were probably 20 to 50 people working beside us and around us who understood a lot about what was happening and who probably got a funny feeling about being in an organization where we all swore to uphold the Constitution, but in fact were engaged in promulgating lies of both omission and commission, mistruths and misdirection, aimed not at our enemies abroad, but against the American people. We were lying with the help of a compliant and war-supportive media to patriots young and old. Millions of Americans were eager to enlist, to fight, to sacrifice their life and health for a made-up government fairy tale. A sense of unease, I believe, was shared by many, many people who never blew a whistle and who never said a word. To their credit, some of these people passively resisted within their organizations and tried to set things straight where they could. Some of these people simply called their assignments guy and got orders out of the Pentagon. Others were removed if they resisted too much. There is always a cost when you seriously question the directions or actions of the bureaucracy that employs you. It is in our country's interest, as security professionals, as intelligence professionals, as soldiers and citizens, as writers and newsmakers, to be sensitive to the lawlessness, the immorality, and the wrongdoing of the bureaucracies and the leaders of the organizations we are a part of. That is the first thing we must cultivate and encourage, a sensitivity and an awareness of something as simple as right and wrong. This is fundamental. From knowing right and wrong, we move to the factor that motivates so many whistleblowers, something that we all share as human beings, and that is a sense of justice. The truth tellers who have been honored with the Sam Adams Award and thousands of others we may not be aware of around the world share a concept of justice. For those who try to correct our U.S. government, particularly in its initiation and exercise of war, state-sanctioned murder, and physical devastation of whole societies, we as Americans have tools that many others around the world don't have. We have a constitution that many of us swore to uphold. Americans tend to have good grounding in the fundamentals of right and wrong, derived from a religion or tradition or both. We live in something that calls itself a republic, and it is a fine form of government with a solid set of rules. But how do we get from a certain moral discomfort, from seeing something going on around us that is wrong, to trying to do something about it? How do we decide if we want to leave the room, turn our backs, put our heads down, or instead take some sort of action that will put us on a collision course with very powerful people? What if we see as truth tellers, what if what we see as truth tellers are like blind men describing an elephant? We see only one part of a larger story. How do we decide that our faith in leadership is misplaced and that more is at stake than just our jobs? When you look at the experiences of people who made the dangerous and difficult decision to act, like Daniel Ellsberg and Sam Adams and Sibel Edmonds, Jesselyn Raddick, Colleen Riley, Thomas Drake, Ed Snowden, Julian Assange, and many others, you realize that speaking up and doing the right thing had a primary impact. That impact wasn't improved transparency, a more informed democracy, a more aware and alert citizenry, and better government decisions by our elected leaders. These were all secondary impacts, and in many cases tenuous, as the improved level of national understanding seems to last for less than a single generation. No, the primary impact was the unimaginable wrath of the state aimed at the life, livelihood, reputation, family character, and credibility of the truth teller. In several cases, this included physical and psychological abuse, prison time, gag orders, and even more devious programs. The rage of the state against these truth tellers is not impulsive and short-lived. It is a forever project funded by tax dollars and fueled by very profitable agendas. Knowing all of this, can we really expect to see a healthy and growing flow of truth tellers, whistleblowers, and simply bold, honest people speaking out about government lies? I think we can, and I'm optimistic about the possibilities of better government through honest, bold, and forthright people working in and around this government. To start with, as I mentioned, we as government employees and uniformed service members need to have a solid sense of right and wrong. We need to cultivate a sense of justice. In a wonderful way, our younger generations are well prepared for this, at least in terms of cultivating a sense of justice. The young people we see portrayed often disparagingly as young socialists may not completely understand the nature of government or the state, but they do cherish ideas of justice. We also need people in government service who are sensitive to what's going on in their organizations and how people are feeling and behaving around them. It is not coincidence that many of the people who have been honored by this award are women who may be paying closer attention to the mood and the morality of their organizations. There's a country song that has a line in it about old men talking about the weather and old women talking about old men. We need both in our organizations to be in tune with what is happening and who is leading us. We need people in government service who are willing to walk away from a job and to say or even broadcast why they are leaving without worrying about the next job, without worrying about being blacklisted, without worrying that they can't make the next house payment or college tuition payment or the alimony and child support payment. We need people in government who travel light, so to speak, and do their job because they love what they are doing and what it stands for. This grounding and lack of a rigid self-identification with the employing bureaucracy is extremely important. Thanks to technology and societal evolution, the younger generations of Americans are very likely to walk away from a job that they believe to be immoral, to act to correct what they see as wrong or unjust, and incidentally are less likely to own a home and more likely to define themselves by what they believe and stand for, not where they work and how many promotions they had planned for themselves in that organization. But even with our younger generations coming into government service with a good sense of justice, a strong sense of self, and a willingness to speak openly about what they believe and know, there is risk when someone questions the collective government story. There is risk in the act of challenging authority in one's peer group, risk of being wrong and suffering a loss of credibility. There is the rational and real risk of incurring the rage of the state and being jailed, harmed, ruined, or even killed on the whispers of an incensed or threatened agency. There is another risk that we really don't talk about much. I think most concerning for many people is the risk that you are actually right, that you have discovered something damning and dark in your country, in your government, in your organization. Once this happens, if it happens, your life is irreversibly changed, and nothing is ever going to be the same. Understanding how your government actually works, in particular how it works to create and provoke war and murder, how it works to extract the wealth of the nation and use this blessing to commit constitutional crimes and untold evil in your name, for many this understanding is not a gift, but a curse. I estimate that 10-20% of the country, 20 to 30 million Americans, many of them veterans of the U.S.'s global adventures in the last 50 years, feel this curse. And many of them deal with it by turning away from the dark side of Washington, D.C., and not talking, writing, or speaking about what they know. If anyone has followed the case of former Marine Sergeant Brandon Raub a few years ago here in Virginia, you realize that the government keeps a close and paranoid eye on what veterans are doing and saying. Given how things work today, they may be wise to turn away silently from the truth they know. I think this is why it is often hard for us to demand more truth-tellers come forward, especially in the defense and security and intelligence arena, when we should be shouting it from the rooftops. Some years ago, I did an online radio program where I would interview interesting people like Ray McGovern and Sam Provance and Sibel Edmonds, among others. One person in our conversation expressed surprise that I was a short, formerly brown-haired woman when he thought that I would be a tall blonde. I was reminded of this in watching Shock and Awe because Rob Reiner and the writers did not know who I was, and they portrayed me as a tall, light-haired woman, a modern-day Viking of sorts. Notwithstanding that this is a popular and attractive stereotype, I think there's something to be learned here. We want to believe that anyone who stands up to authority, who knows his or her own mind, who is willing to enter into a battle of wills with the state and to take a risk, is somehow taller, stronger, bolder, and braver than the rest of us. But it isn't true. There is something remarkably childlike and simple in being honest, in observing without fear what is happening around you, and reporting this to the person who pays the bills. In the case of the national security arena, the bill payer is the American people. To tell the truth is simple, honorable, and good for the health of the republic. The fact that it drives the security apparatus and the government crazy is just icing on the cake. Granted, we all need jobs and our mental health, and we don't want to be imprisoned, tortured, or killed. But the more of us, specifically those working with and inside the U.S. government today who tell the truth, the less likely that government embarrassment will result in harm to a whistleblower, and the less likely in the long run we will see whistleblowers as we tend to see them today. In a world that values honesty, they would be receiving the public commendation of a proud Congress, a grateful media and president, and a contented population. I'm not a Pollyanna, and I'm worried about the role the U.S. government is playing at home and abroad. The kind of devastation that the U.S. tolerates, supports, and initiates around the world, Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, Syria, and of course Yemen comes to mind, the horrendous situation that Julian Assange is still facing as we speak, is not limited to overseas. The industrial warfare state is as dangerous to Americans as it is to Iraqis, Syrians, and Yemenis. The arts of the warfare state are already being practiced here against Americans. We, average Americans, are increasingly controlled, spied on, monitored, tracked, threatened, boxed in, and shut down by tools that were first used and tested on some contrived wartime enemy. You don't need me to tell you this. It's in every newspaper, every day, on every page. It is our modern reality. Truth and transparency are its only antidote. And truth and transparency needs all of us. To live in a society, to be a citizen, to love your country, you cannot sleepwalk through it. People who value wisdom, people who value common sense, people who value justice, and people who believe that being woke is a good thing, congratulations, you are the majority. You are alive, you are in charge of this country, and you can choose. America is worth preserving, healing, and saving. And if she is to be saved, we will do it by first learning the difference between the truth and a lie, and then speaking the truth loudly, boldly, to anyone who will listen, over and over and over again. That was something I wanted to say. But no, questions. Any questions, be happy to take them.
I've often wondered about the role of the media in playing up this war. Now, it's obvious that people like Rumsfeld and Cheney and the moron from Crawford, Texas, should be hauled to the ICC and chained for their war crimes. But I'm wondering whether there's any legal precedent for, or historical precedent, for hauling in those larger figures in the US media who played administration's bidding and ginning up this war. Mm-hmm. I mean, if those people are never to be held accountable, then the U.S. media will play the same game again with Iran. Does anyone know whether there's a legal precedent or international law for holding top members of the media in a country and ginning up a false war of aggression?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's a good question, and I'll tell you what history does tell us, okay? And we all know this if we've looked back. Just go back to the Spanish-American War and remember the Maine. Let's remember the Maine. Let's remember, you give me the pictures and I'll give you your war. This was spoken by Hearst, okay, head of the media conglomerate. If you want to hurt media, you hit them in the pocketbook. We have the public media, they need money. Surely they're sponsored, and they have some sources of income that aren't necessarily us who buy subscriptions. But when the American people stop being interested, and when we start speaking, I guess, about the New York Times, and that's not news, as she said in the movie there, I mean, I think if our attitude is one that we don't believe it, if their biggest commodity in the media is, do you believe what? You know, are you getting value in information? Are they telling you there's a sale and you go and there's no sale, right? You have a newspaper that keeps telling you there's a sale on, and every time you go there's no sale, pretty soon, not only do you not buy it, but you tell all your friends not to buy it, and that newspaper fails, okay? It fails rapidly. Americans, you know, we aren't as well studied in history sometimes. We live in our own moment, okay? We don't look back and we don't remember these wars unless we're watching a movie like this. We don't remember. Most people, my kids watched this movie and they were... Wow, that's cool. I didn't know that happened. You know, because we don't really have time to think about it. So we are a little bit at fault as consumers. And again, I think that's why you support independent media and get the stories out. And don't be afraid to argue. You know, we're in a society, maybe we don't want to argue. We got to argue a little bit. Sometimes we see it in the front page. We need to say, this doesn't sound right. And guess what? I don't think it's right. Do you have any proof of that? No, but I don't think it's right. So let me talk. Let me research. You know, it's not the end of the story because some major media says it 100 times in the same way.
Thanks, Karen. Other questions? Yes, please.
What we've seen, the New York Times and the Washington Post.
Speak loudly.
All right, I'll stand up too.
Stand up.
I'm Ken Meyercourt. What we saw in the movie that exposed the actions of the mainstream media, corporate media, could be labeled fake news. Are Mr. Trump's efforts in exposing fake news helping or hurting?
Well, I've studied Trump too, and I'm at a loss. Okay, so, but here's what I celebrate about President Trump, and you might find this surprising, but the fact that so many people in this country find it very easy, and they should. They should always find it very easy to criticize the president. But in the past, we haven't. And I think many of you who have been around and studied things, you know, we had George Bush's father laid to rest this past week, and many people might have had the opportunity to hear some of the eulogies and some of the statements made. And people have short memories, and we tend to, but it's more pleasant that way. It's more pleasant that way. So, you know, I think with Trump, nobody has the slightest qualm. I don't care, Democrat, Republican, Independent, whatever aspect, you know, we don't have a problem criticizing him at all. I think that's good. We see a tweet and we say, well, that's just crazy. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Trump. Because this is the reaction we should be having most of the time to most of what comes out of Washington, D.C.'s collective mouth and their collective media.
Yes, please.
Ingrid. Yeah, Ray. As you know, I always take the opportunity to argue.
Of course.
I argued much as you just did about Trump, and I've been very happy about him winning the election because I feel that if Hillary had won, there would not have been the reaction or the awakening. However, I'm totally disappointed with the way this has gone, and you talk about people being woke. People are like going like cattle behind this idea of Russiagate. Who are the whistleblowers now? It's not just the ginning up this thing with Iran. Who is saying, look, Russia was not the aggressor in the Kerch Strait, and Ray has spoken extensively about Crimea and the legality of that. Who are people now who are saying, okay, you don't like Trump, but trying to make some kind of fake news about him being in collusion with Russia? This is not forwarding the cause of peace or of justice or of truth.
No, it's true. It's true. It's almost as if a great number of people who don't like Trump, they don't like him so significantly that they want to, hurt him in what's, they're going in the wrong direction, because that's a warlike direction to try to make up stories about a major world power, Russia in particular in this case, but you could pick your country. We don't want to be picking fights because we're mad, and I think there is something to be learned, and it will, I hope over time people will learn it. I don't think to me it's part of being woke, but maybe it hasn't reached everyone. But you have to know yourself, and I think your motivation for what you believe. Like the intel people here, their motivation, yeah, they might have feelings, but they're looking for facts. They're looking for evidence. They're looking for things that make sense. The people that are upset about Trump, and maybe they're mad because Clinton didn't win, but, she had a big uranium deal, which was quite, it was good for both parts of that deal. So if I was Putin, I would definitely be supporting Clinton, not Trump, because Trump, you can't tell what he's going to do, and he's going to strike a hard bargain. I'm already in dealings with Clinton. I'm making money. I'm having a good time. I'm being a good little capitalist, if you want to call it that. So we should encourage people, and I don't know how much you can do it. Independent media is providing evidence for us and information. But really, you should encourage people to check their motivation and just make sure that hatred isn't the fundamental driver of what they believe, that maybe it's facts.
Great. Gareth Porter has a question.
Karen, very, very fine presentation. Thank you so much for that, and congratulations. I just wanted to come back to part of your story, which I personally found most interesting, which is that you were able to see the Israeli operatives coming into the Pentagon and be there for a great part of this period. And I wondered if you could spell out what you were able to discern, what you were able to learn about what they were doing, how it was related to the entire enterprise of coming up with this fake intelligence analysis.
Yeah, well, certainly they were involved in the fundamental motivation for how do we get America into this war. I think that was in their interest, and they took that quite seriously. Two aspects led me to awareness. One is knowing who the individuals were that were assigned to our office, mainly political appointees. I would Google them, and people would say, oh, this guy, where did this guy come from? And they would say this think tank and that think tank, and I would look those think tanks up, and they were often Israeli think tanks. There are a number of them here. And if they weren't Israeli think tanks, they were think tanks that took a very Likudnik approach to both Israel and American foreign policy. So these are the people there. Of course, I knew some of them, and you could talk to them, very nice people, but none with military experience at all. And if they had any desire to serve in the military, it wasn't ours. So this is it gives you a sense. And that's sort of just the sense that I had of these people and the study. And again, information is totally available. And of course, nothing on the internet seems to go away, and I think that's a good thing. And you can research all of this. And so information is out there if you're interested. I was interested. And I was interested in part because, you look at it, who's in your office and where did they come from and how did they get the job? This is in the Pentagon where I worked, and anybody's been up there, these high-level jobs, they're quite competitive. People want these jobs. They want them to punch their tickets for their next job. It's a great thing. So how people can, and some of these people that were coming in didn't have a lot of experience that I thought, so I research how, whatever, there's that. The other thing that was a my function is there were a group of guys coming, a guest visitor, I didn't know who they were at the time. And after 9/11, the security procedures in the Pentagon were tightened up and people had to have escorts and they had to be met at the gates and that kind of thing. And so one of these new political appointees, certainly a neocon, happened to be a Jewish guy, he said, hey, I'm tied up in this meeting. Can you run down and get these folks? And he said, there's six of them, so we're going to need two people. And I can't remember, I think the other guy came later. I went down there because they'd been waiting. So I went down to the desk to get them. And they were very upset that they had been waiting. They didn't understand why they shouldn't be in, and they were upset because they'd been waiting. And they came through very rapidly, and then they took off. And I was going to say, well, I'll escort you where you're going. And they're like, we know where we're going. And they took off really fast. I mean, I'm a fast walker, but I had to almost jog to keep up with them. And they went into, whose office was it? I can't remember. It wasn't Fife's office. It was Lutie's. The guy above him. No, Lutie. It was above Fife and Lutie. It might have been Wolfowitz's office. Mm-hmm. And on the E-ring there. But they go in, and I'm trying to be a good little citizen, you know, good little, you know, Air Force Lieutenant Colonel, escorting these people. I say, hey, here's the sign-in thing at the door. There's four secretaries standing there, and here's the book, and you've got to sign in. And I'm a terrible storyteller. But anyway, the door was shut, and they tried to barge in on another meeting. And so the secretary blocked the door with their physical person. Said, you gotta wait. And then I said, hey, here's the book, guys, you can sign in. This we can do in our spare time while we're killing time before we see the guy. And they said, we're not doing that. And I looked at the secretary and she goes, we never make him sign in. So, you know, there you have it. These people are quite familiar with the Pentagon. I mean, I would have had to sign in. If I came from another building in uniform, I would have signed in. This is typical, anybody who works in government, you know, if it's this classified area, SCIF, you sign in. And these people didn't sign in. They didn't need to sign in. They didn't feel like they should sign in. And we didn't require them to do it.
Who were they?
I'm sorry. A bunch of Israeli generals. Yeah, that's who they were.
Israeli generals.
And also the ambassador. He had brought him in. And so some of the guys were stationed here, but I think three or four of them had flown over. You know, they were on a trip. And this was in the time frame. This was in December, January 2002, January 2003 time frame. Yeah, when you see things like that, see, you know, military, we follow rules, right? You know, that's what we do. We wear uniforms, so we all look the same. And so we're used to things being kind of consistent. And when you see something like that, it's pretty obvious that something weird is going on. So it doesn't take a genius. And yet, I think, many people noticed and saw what I saw. And they either didn't feel that it was bad enough, or they internalized it, or they got out of there. Or they said, it's not my job to do something about it. And you know, I'm a little bit different, but not that much. I think if you see something wrong, you know, see something. I loved it when they at Homeland came up with see something, say something. What a joke. Because we had that great government. If all the people in government would see something, say something, we'd be living in a free country if that was at peace.
And how you reached out to these guys, and you're portrayed as being very naive about how it works in an interview. You're supposed to tell them how you want to be identified, if it's background or off the record. Is that true? Do you really know anything about how to talk to reporters?
Yeah, what it was is, of course, every once in a while we'd see Warren's and Jonathan's articles in the, they had a compilation, a daily compilation, what did they call it? I can't remember.
Early Bird.
Early Bird would come out and, of course, we all love to read the Early Bird all morning because there's all kinds of articles in it. And great articles. They're selected from all kinds of media on security issues and things that we want to know about. And I love to read the Early Bird. And, of course, I could tell who was telling the story that I happened to see on my desk, classified top secret, but I knew it was not even right, repeated in the New York Times. So there's a little data point that goes, wow, how'd that happen? Who's leaking stuff? Because I knew who was kind of putting the cherry-picked stuff together, because we were given the same thing. We were being propagandized. There was a set of talking points that were updated periodically that would come to us to include in any briefing that we prepared for any of the higher-ups. And this is not just my office, anybody in the Pentagon, regardless of where you're working, if you gave a briefing that went up to a higher up, if you had anything to say on terrorism or Iraq, this is what you would say, and it would be a cut and paste. You would cut whatever you thought you had from reading intelligence, and you would paste whatever was sent out to you on a routine basis. And so I knew what was being sent out, and then when I saw it verbatim in the New York Times, I said, well, somebody's got this, right? And they're giving it to Judith Miller. Why would they do that? Of course, that was naive. Why would they do that? I didn't know. I thought it was weird. But I noticed the Landay and the Knight Ridder reporters and Warren's articles were extremely accurate. They were reporting what I was seeing. They were discounting stuff as it should have been discounted, and they were asking the right questions. And so I think I emailed him. I said, hey, great article, you know, you're on the right track kind of thing. And I forget how we first talked, but I was happy to meet him. And I met him in uniform downtown. I did meet him in a restaurant, open air type thing like that in D.C. But I came in uniform on my lunch break. I mean, it's like, what are you going to do? I'm telling you that, and plus, if I didn't, how would they know? How would they know? You know.
If I could follow, how did you know it wasn't true? You were overhearing discussions across the hall, I understand.
Well, you know okay.
You weren't getting the real stuff, were you? You were getting
Yeah, we were getting the real stuff. That's the problem. See, if I hadn't been getting the real stuff, I might have been very easily propagandized. Yeah, I was seeing two versions, the real stuff and then what was coming out of the Office of Special Plans. And the reason I was seeing it, because we were, it wasn't like I was watching it through the hallway, that kind of is weird. It was because we shared offices in the summer of 2002, so I knew all the folks that worked there. It was pretty crowded, people were crammed together, so there is talk, you know, you're talking, you're sharing, you know who these people are. Then they moved to another office on the fifth floor, one floor up from us, and at that point, we had a big meeting, and I guess it was in August, and Bill Lutie was our boss, and he was also the boss of the Office of Special Plans, and he said, they've moved, thank God. Well, he's with them. I mean, he spent his time up there. But he said, now we have more space, but here's how it's going to work. And he instructed, it was an office meeting. Here's how it's going to work. These guys are going to produce the talking points. In other words, the storyline. And that's the storyline you're going to put in all your stuff. And so naive question would be, and I think somebody else asked it, not me, what about our normal way of getting our stuff to put in our reports, which is by looking at the most current intelligence from DIA? And they said, no, don't worry about this. This will make your job easier, because all you have to do is take. So we're, and you know, it did make our job easier in a way, because we had this preformed stuff. So, and I think what got me is when I saw some of the same verbiage used exactly in the newspaper. Mm. And because ours were classified, not top secret, but it was classified secret. And the other weird thing, I hate to go on and on, but it is interesting. One of the fights that a colonel, an army colonel, who did find another job, and he did fight the good fight. He didn't go to the media, but he tried to work in channels. But one of the things they refused to do, Ray, you'll love this, they refused to put classifications on the paragraphs. And anybody who gave them any type of document with classification of the paragraphs, which is how you have to do it, I'm sorry, it has to be done that way. Yeah, so they said, no, you can't do that. And so they just have classification at top and bottom, which again, makes it real easy to just take a page and give it to somebody, because then, hell, well, you didn't really classify, because these paragraphs aren't marked classified. But they were. All of this was geared, and I think the movie makes it clear. You know, there was an agenda, there was a proposal. They needed to fool some people. And the American people was a big target. They also needed to own some folks in the system. And so they ran a great propaganda campaign. It is not unprecedented to go to war with propaganda. The thing that Senator Byrd said about the Tonkin Gulf thing, I mean, I grew up. I was 40 years old before I realized Tonkin Gulf was based on a made-up story. And that's kind of weird to be 40 years old and discover something you believe for basically 25 years. They wouldn't do that. So, but sure enough, they would do that. They did do that. They have done that. And they're doing it now. And this is the problem.
I'd just like to interject that I worked for the CIA for almost 30 years. Our job was to run a check on these guys. The reason Truman set us up was because he didn't believe a damn thing coming out of the Pentagon. They said the Russians were 10 feet tall. He knew, you know, he was not the brightest guy in the world, but he knew that the Russians couldn't be 10 feet tall. And from the State Department, he's always getting information defending their particular policies. And so I want an agency that reports directly to me, and I want them to have career protection for telling the truth. Wow. That's why I joined, right? And so the story here is that George Tenet and James Clapper, as we all know now, Clapper says, we were so eager to please the administration in their wish to start a war that we found things that weren't there. What things? Weapons of mass destruction. Who's Clapper? He was in charge of all the imagery analysis before Iraq. So, if Taliban, whom you're you saw there, says there's a suspected chemical weapons production site at these coordinates. And the imagery analyst would look at those coordinates and say, there's a chicken coop. Guess what never got, just what given never got to Rumsfeld or Cheney or anything else. I want to say another thing here. Larry knows this quite well. I remember him testifying before a committee about six, 7 years ago, and he was asked, how was it that the government functioning, the way it's set up to prevent this kind of thing, how come it could just be completely disregarded? And I remember what you said, Larry. First you said two words. No, I'll say three words. The vice president, okay? Now, let me just say this too. Our first three awardees, Colleen Rowley, Catherine Gunn, and Sibel Edmonds, all women. Oh, isn't that interesting? We were lusting after a man that we could nominate, and finally, Craig Murray, the ambassador from Uzbekistan, didn't like torture. He got thrown out of the foreign office, and he became our fourth. But what does that say, you know? What does it say that Colleen Rowley, like a year and a half from being able to retire, writes these memos to St. Robert Mueller, who at that point was not canonized yet, he was just beatified. He was the head of the FBI, okay? And she was saved by some senators from being cashiered. But that's guts. Now, I did know when we saw this, it was great. Gareth was there with me. We were at this premiere of the film. And we didn't, we saw the news, some stuff. Gareth came onto it earlier than I. But Karen was walking down at the Q&A, right? And I said, well, that looks like Karen. But she came by and she took the mic and she said, I just wanted to say that the woman depicted in the Pentagon there, that's me. And, her closest friends. She didn't know that, okay? So now, the other thing I didn't know until I talked to Karen just this week was, It's wrong in the depiction. The only thing that's substantially wrong, substantially in my view, is that woman's not in uniform. I mean, talk about guts. And I asked Karen about that. I said, if you're going to do this kind of operation, for God's sake, why are you doing it in uniform? She said, well, I needed bona fides. I needed them to believe me that I was a light colonel in the Air Force, and that's where I sat. So, and how... half a year from retirement? So, these things really speak volumes about courage and conscience. And, if the film doesn't do it for you, maybe some of Karen and Larry's remarks do. So that's my little bit here, It's the women that have the courage, at least in the beginning. Now we filled in with some men who were, kind of measured up, but now we're back to a woman, and we're just delighted that's... Is there other women? I have another question, because we should probably... If there's another question, let's have it. Otherwise... well, Karen, let me see a couple of... Oh, yeah, there's one.
I just wanted... Follow up on what Gareth said about these bills that are now in the Congress.
Right.
Because I do think this is extremely important. I mean, the 63-37 vote is procedural, but it's a shot that it will come back this week. I know Walter Jones and Ro Khanna have a bill in the House. They tried a privilege resolution. It was deprivileged. But I think going into January, and maybe not even that long, we can move this now. So I just think that we should all mobilize to do that.
Right, this is the time, right?
Right, let me add to that when Paul Ryan deprivileged the bills, he broke the law.
Absolutely.
The War Powers Resolution was very clear in the discussion around it and in its own language.
Yep.
It is privilege, which means no chairman, no speaker, no leader, minority, majority can stop it from going to the floor of the particular House for debate. That's three times the Republicans have illegally derailed that bill. We went to the parliamentarian. He told us, you have the right. It will go forward. They defied him.
Right.
let's do it.
I'm just going to say.
Larry, what party he belongs to?
Yeah. What's that?
Ask Larry what party he belongs to.
What party do you belong to, Larry?
There are three of us left.
But no, I just want to thank all of y'all for coming tonight, and I want a special shout out to my family, my mother who surprised me from North Carolina.
Just close up a couple of remarks. There's so much gloom and doom around that, we need a little encouragement here. If this is an encouragement, I don't know what is. All you young people out there, all you young careerists, there's more important things than careers. There's more important things than retirement. There's conscience. There's courage. And somebody was saying about George H.W. Bush earlier this month, saying that, his hallmark was prudence. And prudence, as Aristotle and Aquinas said so well, is the keystone for all virtue. Well, you got that wrong, folks. I happen to know something about Aquinas. I have memorized portions of Aquinas. And what he said was courage. Courage is the foundation of all virtue. If you have no guts, all other virtue is specious.
That's right.
And there were key times when George H.W. Bush had no guts. So I just want to, before we finish here, just to kind of ask you to very deliberately turn around and see what good company you're in. Just kind of, if we can't stand together here and reinforce each other and say, Karen can do that, maybe I can do it too. And not just vent. A last little vignette I'll tell you about this Sam Adams thing is, we recruited Bill Odom. Who's Bill Odom? You know who he is.
Great army general and man of
integrity, right. He haven't beheaded the NSA. And he played by the rules. Those rules were very stringent. They were draconian. Thou shalt not collect information on American citizens. It's the first commandment out there at NSA. When he heard that Michael Hayden, under the influence of Dick Cheney, had played fast and loose with the Fourth Amendment, collecting everything on everybody. You know what he said? He said, he should be court-martialed and the president should be impeached. That's what Odom said. Now, we don't have too many Odoms around, but when we invited him to join Sam Adams Associates for Integrity and Intelligence, he responded to my email saying, only if health insurance for psychiatry is included. I said, no, what do you mean? He said, only so that we can vent freely with one another, because we're going to have to vent for a lot of years over this. Unfortunately, Bill died. Lastly, I just want to say that we're not allowed to be depressed or allowed to be discouraged here. It's just not part of it. One of my favorite things is I.F. Stone. And what he said was this, look, you have to realize that in this business of conscience and courage, conviction and justice, you have to enter this you have to keep your bearings. You're gonna lose. You have to expect you're gonna lose, and then some fine day, somebody who thinks like you, or Karen, or Larry, or John Kiriakou, somebody who thinks like you and has the courage to act wins, okay? So we can't be depressed now, because we're setting an example for those days when that happens. And if you look around you, you can see there are enough of us, and it is really up to us. There is only us. Thank you, Karen, and thank you all for coming.